Hello, everyone, the good people of the Ukraine. This is Nadia Milan from the University of Johannesburg, and the research project Izindaba Zokudla, which means conversations about food. And I'm very, very happy to make this presentation on the history of this project. I'm making this presentation in order to show people what could be done to generate Zokudla. We can go to the next slide. Izindaba Zokudla is a research project of the University of Johannesburg, and we have been working since 2013 with farmers and food processors and also stakeholders in Johannesburg to set up this project. This project received a very important boost in the beginning from a Dutch NGO called Transforum, which is defunct at the moment. But they partnered with another international NGO, Rios Partners, and they spread multi-stakeholder engagement methods across the world in order for stakeholders or actors to attempt change to the food system. So they trained us in these methods, and I even went to Detroit. The University of Michigan was also involved, and that inspired us to start with Izindaba Zokudla. So you can go to the next slide. So Izindaba Zokudla, in my background, I worked with farmers in the rural areas of South Africa. We were able to take all these insights that we learned from Rios Partners and Transforum and transform them into a technology development project. That also ended later on, but it's still continuing in another form. I wanted to situate the technology development in a bigger social forum wherein we could attempt other changes that would make the technology more effective. So you can go to the next slide. So what we did is, and please excuse the rain, it's really wonderful. Izindaba Zokudla started in that way with just a few workshops, but now it is a series of social innovation events that concerns technology, business, and also the farmers lab. Around these events, a whole community of practice has emerged from university departments, the NGO Slow Food, the Organic Sector Association. A lot of the mainstream agriculture players are also involved. The city, the province, and also national departments. But there are many farmers that come, and I actually, every single person I met since 2013, I took their phone number, and that is a mass message a system that I still use to invite people to my events. And now we're at almost 1,400 people that we invite. Now, the future, which I will conclude on, is the construction of an innovation system in the University of Johannesburg that brings in outside stakeholders into the university so we can attempt action projects that change the food system. So you can take the next slide. So the next slide shows the first workshop we did in Johannesburg. We had very little money, and you can see there was no tablecloths, but we managed to hold three workshops, October, November, December 2013, that developed a strategic plan for urban agriculture in Soweto. Now, Soweto is the previously a racialized black or African suburb in Johannesburg. There's 1 million people living there. It's very sophisticated. It's very modern. It's been upgraded. But it is, in many senses, a really important place in South Africa, because if we can change Soweto, we can change all the poor areas of the country. So you can go to the next slide. So we had the October workshop, then the a November workshop, which brought in stakeholders so they can do things with the farmers. And then we had a December workshop where we kind of implemented these projects. And you can see there's a local newspaper who wrote a story about us. And what happened with the stakeholders? The stakeholders in this, the November workshop, mostly came from the university, and they started working with farmers on their own. So this was outside my control because we wanted to use the workshop to popularize the technology development. And the next slide shows you the technology. But next to us, a lot of initiatives came as well. In this this Ulimi urban food cooler, which was designed by Natalia Tofas, an industrial designer. This is a food cooler. I mean, in South Africa, it's very hot, but this thing works with only water, and it can enable someone who sells food on the sidewalk with no technology or any a shop or any building around them to keep their food cool while they sell it. We couldn't manufacture this. It was a very effective product. It was patented, but the costs were very high to manufacture, and but we are still investigating that. So this was really, really interesting because I wanted to take the technology and put it in a larger context, and the larger context can make the big changes that we want, and where the technology is just a small little thing. So it's interesting theoretically. Can go to the next slide. So we did that, but then it all grew much bigger. And then it was especially the graphic design who helped us. Here you can see a beehive, which is the latest product from the technology design. So this is a beehive that was designed for a fourth year industrial design project, but for the fifth year master's degree, the manufacturing system was developed. So we went from technology to a manufacturing system, and now we can integrate it with our business forum so we can create entrepreneurs who can produce honey in the township amongst people or who are very poor. So the first thing with systemic change is really to create income generating opportunities. The next slide, please. The next slide, you will see the graphic design students came on board. And this is a tour of a medicinal garden in Soweto that we did. There's the farmer who's a very well-trained permaculture farmer. And he showed the students his garden, and that actually inspired them to do much better designs. And you'll see the next slide what the designs were. And so they could really understand the context. And in design thinking, this was really the immersion phase. So in order to also create money for poor food processors and farmers, we organized with the Soweto Theater, which is a very modern, sustainable building and a large building, very prominent. We organized a farmer's market, and they allowed us to do it for free. And we did about four markets there. The first two was very good, and the last two were absolute disaster. We sold nothing. And that is when we realized that people don't only buy food, they buy the culture around food and a narrative or a story about food. So this gives you an idea of the bigger context and the bigger ecosystem that has to emerge for significant and real social change. The next slide, please. So we learned a lot of lessons with that. And actually, 2 years later, someone actually succeeded in setting up a business that runs a farmer's market in Soweto, and she's still successful. So after the technology development project commenced and ended, because it moved to the master's level, we had spare budget and capacity. So what I did is, because a lot of people wanted a farmer's school. So I said, let's start a farmer's school and innovation lab. And here you can see in the photograph, me lecturing at the opening day. So this was really great because this innovation lab allowed all kinds of things that are unplanned and planned, anything to take place. And it was an open participatory forum where stakeholders and farmers can connect on their own and do their own action projects. And actually today I'm realizing a lot of things have happened that I never knew about, and it has moved the economic development and agricultural development for marginalized people in South Africa from the history of apartheid has moved them forward. And they have actually succeeded in using the opportunities in these events for their own projects. And this is very important. We must never do anything for anyone else. The theorist Michel Foucault said, there's a great indignity in speaking for someone else. So what I did is I said, I'm going to create a context so other people can commence with action projects and they can complete the projects. Because in the end of the day, I can do nothing for food systems change. The only ones who can do something is the farmers, and when they are successful entrepreneurs and when they produce food in a sustainable way. Once that happens and they start making transactions, that is the answer. Nothing else will help. We can teach people, we can do everything, it doesn't help. The farmer must be able to set up their own enterprise that's successful. It's very, very important. And that was the philosophy of the Farmers Lab. Next slide, please. And it is proving to be quite interesting because you'll see at the end how this has materialized in a really important action project. So what we also did is, in the Farmers Lab, we could start experimenting with introducing new technology to farmers so they can add more value to the market. So on the slide, you see the details of a farmer who lives just outside Johannesburg. And she is she owns her own biogas unit, which generates energy for her. So what I did is, and this is important, I put her on stage together with a professor from engineering who is an expert on biogas. So on this day, the revolution really started. Because on this day, we could have a very highly technical, expert-driven lecture come, and also a layman's farmer's lecture. And Tuki spoke in isiZulu and Sepedi and Sesotho, which are the local languages. So we could create a context for not only building bridges across society, which is very important in South Africa, because we have a history of discrimination and oppression, but it could also build bridges between rich and poor, expert and non-expert. And we could start playing with these technologies and humanize them and make them accessible. This was great because at the moment, we have another project running that is actually training 100 bricklayers to build biogas plants on farmers' farms. These are small farms, and that's already commenced. So you know, this is how these things happen. And I think the lesson that I want to give to you, the good people of the Ukraine and everyone who's listening, is that we need to, the systems theory word is, we need to create a cascade of actions. So the Farmers Lab starts that. So, you know, we have the professor and the farmer talking about this. Someone takes up the idea, builds their own biogas on their own. We don't know about it. That connects to another person. And eventually it comes back to us. And then we have actually created now an ecosystem of change. And I think it's very important that we, you know, we need to train people in agriculture, sustainability, circular economy. But once again, we must understand that it is the farmer out there on their own who have to complete the change process. Next slide, please. And this is something that has really influenced the Farmers Lab. What has happened as well is the engineers started the agribusiness solution for the youth. And they just started playing with these ideas, and they started interacting with it was the Open Food Network, who had an app for food sales, which was not complete. And you can go to the next slide. And in that group, I wasn't even part of it. A private company, Money Tree Group, came in and they developed the Kula app, which has won many awards now. And that's the next slide. They developed the Kula app, which is an app that connects farmers to the market. And you can look at even the next slide. You can download this, but I don't know if it's in the Ukraine. They have a website. But you can see there's the supply chain, which is a four or five link supply chain. The supermarkets in South Africa have an 11 to 15 link supply chain. So this app is actually very, very radical. It has traded more than R1 million, and it's actually in its third phase of development. They are winning awards, and they are well on the way to become, I believe, in a few years, one of the major players in the South African food scape. So the reason I'm saying this is I'm saying to everyone that if you create the context for the right stakeholders who also want to see this change, if you can get them in the same room and just allow them to realize their interests, then they do things like this. I can mention many others, the next slide, please, that have done this, from graphic design, from many others. We have seen a cascade of activities. So what you see there is the Rainbow Maize Revival Project. You know, in the old days in Africa, the maize was multicolored in America as well. And I'm sure some of you guys, Ukraine also produces a lot of maize. Some of the old people will have these kinds of maize, and they look beautiful. And organic retailers who are high end and sell at very high price, we started working with them through Slow Food to establish a value chain from farmers to the supermarkets. And the first harvest, as I speak, is coming in, and it is being developed. The branding that you see there was developed by a graphic design student who was given a job by another company, Indigo New Media, who had an interest in this, and they are involved in that. And they paid the graphic designer to design this packaging. And the packaging was also taken to Slow Food Ark of Taste. And the Ark of Taste is the custodian of many of these seeds. And through the Ark of Taste, we distribute the seeds every year. And then the farmers bring the maize, and they can sell it on their own. And the packaging, they can also get printed on their own, or they can, I suppose, get it from the Ark of Taste. So you can see that the whole community of practice started around this really interesting project, and all Izindaba Zukudla did was give them the guts or the opportunity to start with this. Then it goes outside the research project and it realizes itself. The next slide, please. So you can see that this happens, and that actually means you can have an impact much wider than just what you do as a practitioner or an activist or an academic. Now, this is a more sophisticated project that also was launched through Izindaba Zukudla and developed outside and inside of it. So this Awiwa, it says farm in a box, but this is linked to another project which incubates rooftop farms in the inner city of Johannesburg. So we have a very large city, and it's very, very dirty and slummy, and there's a lot of crime. But people can start farms on the top of the skyscrapers, this is what has been possible. So Awiya is also run by Indigo New Media, and it's not just rooftop farms. We actually have another project or opportunity that's emerging, and that is to link this. These farms to an electric delivery vehicle, which students from the University of Delft Technical University has developed. So this all is much more than I can do, but I manage the ecosystem. And in the ecosystem, all kinds of things can happen. The next slide, please. And you can see these are very sophisticated projects and products, and they can work. So what is the Farmers Lab? The Farmers Lab is really interesting, because what I have found is that businesses who want to work with farmers have great difficulty in reaching farmers. So what do? I invite them. So here's two guys, and it's actually significant that they are white or white skinned, because most of the farmers that they are speaking to are black or African, and it reflects the racial history. But of course, the Afrikaners had a very strong influence over the food system in South Africa, they being Dutch farmers, long 200-300 years ago, and they still dominate. So what they are doing, they could come to the lab and they could promote their products to these farmers. So these guys, they sell an Internet of Things livestock pen, which measures and weighs the animals all the time. And this high-tech solution, they've already sold two of them to the farmers in there. So this means I'm having mainstream impact through the Farmers Lab. And in this way, you can also take the mainstream guys who might not be sustainable and put them in a context that pushes them to become more sustainable. And that's very important especially for, I think, you know, the interest of a permaculture farmer. So, you know, we have to work with everybody. I don't just work with permaculture or organic farmers. I work with everybody, but I do believe that the biological systems are much better. But, you know, you have to accommodate everyone to have very specific impacts as well. You can go to the next slide. But I'm seeing that this is actually the way to go, and that, you know, interstakeholders can use the lab to achieve their own ends. The same with a University of Johannesburg department, or the School of Communications, which is a very large school. So they started a storytelling project, so that they took their journalism students to the farmers, and each journalism student would write up a story about each farmer's a farm. And then those stories, you can go to the next slide, we will then use, or the farmers can then take that story. There's the professor, Mariki Berger, telling us about that. You can go to the next slide. So these stories, we teach the students to put them onto their Facebook, Instagram profiles, whatever, and also on the apparate.co profile, which is a system from a professor in Germany who lives in South Africa. So now we are showing the farmers how to create an enterprise in a digital ecosystem where they can interact with their clients much more directly, where they are not shielded from the clients by their retailers and all of that. And this is a really, really important thing, because now we can shorten the supply chains. And the other thing that's really important is, you will know and I know that farmers receive so little from wholesalers or retailers for their produce. And that is why we have a crisis in the food system. So the way to solve this problem is to create a link from the farmer to the customer. And that is what we're trying to do. It's very, very difficult, but Apparate is going to be important in that. But we also realize we need many kinds of apps, and these apps are complex. They in a sense have to be mobile. They can't be on the laptop. There are many, many things that have to be optimized for an app for a farmer to work. You can go to the next slide. But this is not a problem. And if it's not a problem for me, I cannot solve this solution. I cannot solve this problem, but the farmers must solve that problem. But what I can do is I can add the right kind of information to make that work. So what happened is, on the day when we discussed that, we also were blessed by the attendance of Dr. Robert, he's doing his doctorate from the University of Tokyo, who was doing work on an ICT framework for the food system. And this overlapped completely with Apparate. So we had an expert show the farmers from a highly theoretical way why this is important. And then we also could show them how you actually do this. How do you create your own digital enterprise? So, you know, these things, I didn't, you know, I invited him and he emailed me, but he found me on the internet. I didn't plan this, but this really happened, and it led to many, many things. So you have to, if you are going to be playing in a community of practice, you must allow the surprising things to happen. You must create the conditions for things that you didn't dream is possible to happen, because they will. And they will probably happen also outside your event. So it's really important to have this event to show to farmers that they are actually very important, that they can make it, that they can be radical, that they can change the food system. It is possible, and it is possible. I can tell you that. The next slide, please. And you know, the experience has been like that. So what we had to do is we had to scale this up. And I'm going to conclude on two points on how we scaled it up. So the one way we wanted to scale it up is we worked with Slow Food, and they actually came to one of the events. We had a food processing day in the farmer's lab where we invited the people who make jams and condiments and achar and blachang and all these kind of things that you put on your food, the sauces and those things. We invited them and we had a competition, who can make the tastiest sauce. So on the day, Slow Food came as a judge. And they said, but this is so great, let's have a bigger conference for this. And then what happened is, all of a sudden, the Soweto Eat-In materialized. An eat-in in Italy is a very small gathering where people eat pizza in the village square in Italy. But what we did is we said, no, we're going to make a big conference. So we had the Free People's Conference. We had a chef's competition where we slaughtered a grass-fed, sustainably raised Nguni, which is the indigenous cow breed, for the day. And the chefs had to make a meal with that cow. And they had to use the whole cow. They couldn't just use the better cuts. They had to use everything, the heart, the lungs, the stomach. We didn't use the head, which is a pity. But all of that happened. And it showed the world that we can eat sustainably, that we can produce the sustainable food locally, and that this could be something that generates income for poor people. Next slide, please. So you can see this was the Free People's Conference, where we put together experts and lay people in the same room. So in front of you there is a professor from the University of Cape Town, Laura Pereira. Next to her from the right is a farmer who makes an indigenous tea. Next to her is someone from BioWatch, who is an NGO protecting the environment. Next to her is another farmer, and next to her is an activist who grows indigenous foods in the Cape, and then, of course, Samantha, our moderator. So this is important. We have to put experts and lay people all together on the same stage so that people can discuss things. And it was such a wonderful experience because in the audience, you know, we had true social cohesion taking place. We had people from rich areas and poor areas sitting next to each other, exchanging, becoming friends, forming relationships. And those relationships eventually became the future businesses that we are now seeing coming out. Next slide, please. So we will hold this again this year, somewhere in March. And there you can see, this was the latest one. On the right is a guy. All those seeds are indigenous seeds, and this is for free for farmers. And it attracts about 2,000-3,000 people, these events. So you can see the guy with indigenous seeds. There's another guy selling local vegetables. And then another guy with, also kind of vegetables. And, it was a really, really great day where people from all walks of life interacted at the Soweto Eat-In, the slow food Soweto Eat-In. And it's really becoming an important event. And these events have become markers of systemic change. And it is really, we show the world that we can eat very well if we eat and sustainably. And I think that's quite important. The next slide, please. So we're hosting the eat-in that shows how this works to the whole world. Now, to conclude, we needed to take this further. Now, of course, we at the university, we also need to bring in revenue for the university. We had to also make sure that all of this is good for publications and postgraduate research. We also need to make sure that that we can create revenue through short learning courses for farmers so that the farmers can also improve their income. And we also knew that we could also commercialize some of these things. Sorry, the cat's in the way. Commercialize some of these things because some of these technologies that are still being designed have commercial impact. So the way it would work is this. For the Farmers Lab, we would have a rights issue, and sponsors can pay money to have their banners at the Farmers Lab. We attract between 100 and 400 people every time, and it is done. Everything is captured on Facebook, so there's a large readership, and that might just pay for the sponsors. And we have never advertised, so we think we can increase the reach of this event, and that will bring in money from sponsorship. Then we will also gain sponsorship to start, that's number two of the products, short learning programs. So what is actually happening is our Center of Enterprise has already developed those programs. So all we need now is a sponsor, and therefore a farmer can come from the Farmers Lab, can go to the university and get trained in agroecology, enterprise development, technology, many, many things, financial management, all of that, nutrition, all of that. And the university can get revenue, not from the farmer, but from a sponsor. And then we will also say to the sponsors, if you sponsor the event and this the learning program, please sponsor a postgraduate student. So the postgraduate student can work with the farmers to develop either technology or to develop a really good research project, doctorate or master's, and that can then feed back into the research project. And those technologies and ideas or enterprises that are viable can then be funded further by investors or sponsors in a commercialization fund, and that we link with our own technology office. And of course, this also, it's a lot of time for me, and we are looking for a sponsor to sponsor me and my position as senior lecturer at the university. So this is a whole story, indigenous or iterative attempt to create a system of innovation. And what I can say to conclude with is, I read a lot of social innovation theory, multi-stakeholder engagement, classical action research work, and of course, actor network theory, mainly from Bruno Latour, but also Manuel Castells Network Society. And what I find in this literature is a new approach to economic development, where economic development is not a liberal exercise of making as much profit as possible, but where economic development is actually something that takes place when we have communities who use the resources that there are in a sustainable way to create the right kind of value that would lead to even greater sustainability, which would lead to even greater value. So this is the way we conceptualize economic development. It is through communities of practice, through collaboration, and through enterprise development. And it's those things that we believe is how we should attempt real change to the food system, and that will give a bigger place for ecologically based production methods because they are better in the food market. And I believe this could be useful to anyone in agricultural development, in activism, etc. And you can read my paper on ResearchGate. I'm changing it to get published somewhere, but you can certainly read that. It's sometimes better to read the rough ones. But this is what I offer to you, and I'm very, very happy to offer this to the good people of the Ukraine, and I do hope you can learn from this.
Thank you very much, Nauda. It's a very inspiring presentation, and what is especially important from my point of view, that basically you could economically develop the farmlands, the countrysides, and the country anywhere in developing country, just by connecting the right people and just moving the academic education close to the end users or stakeholders. And linked to that, I have a question, because we, the NGO Permaculture in Ukraine, we organize a lot of meeting like this, national convergences, meetings for farmers, and as well as you organize a lot of meetings. So could you summarize or give some several advices how to make these meetings successful? Because for me, the very critical moment, because of course at the meeting, everyone is inspired and have a lot of ideas, but after that, how to make the meeting in a way that after meeting, there will be some output.
Okay, the key thing is you must never only have one kind of person. So if you only invite permaculture people, it's not going to work. So you must get the permaculture. You must think who can they connect to? Restaurants, food wholesalers, distributors. You have to have even the people you don't like. they must come there. So you need to manage the diversity, because diversity can bring innovation. That's the first thing. So I think that's important. And if you read Danny Burns and McLachlan, Anderson and McLachlan, and there's a lot of really good work. They all say systemic change is when you make change at many places in the system at the same time. Now, that's impossible. So the only way you can do that is to bring all the stakeholders that represent the different points in the food system that want sustainability. Bring all of them together and say to them, guys, now you can develop it. But don't tell them what to develop. So what I do is in the farmer's lab, and this is my other part of my answer, the farmer's lab is structured in four or five themes. The first thing is I give an editorial. So I come from the university, and there's a lot of fraud and corruption in the world. So I come and I give an honest, truthful lecture from the university. And that's very important. Then I have space for farmers' announcements. And that sometimes takes 2 hours. And I give space to any farmer to announce anything. So people announce, I've got vegetables for sale, or I want to start a business that sells this, or I'm looking to buy that, or I have this opportunity available, or there's funding from here, all kinds of things. So farmers can make their own connections in the event. And that's important. So what we do is every announcement, we take a photograph of the person. We write down the details on the blackboard. We photograph that. All of that is posted on Facebook, so people can find it years later. And you can look at my website. There's many, many things. And we also type it up digitally, so people can digitally search for these things. Now, Facebook is not so good, but it's okay. Then after that, very simple, two lectures, expert to farmer lecture and farmer to farmer lecture. Hopefully about the same thing. And in that way, you can humanize stuff. And then you must leave a time for lunch so people can mingle and make their own connections and do their own thing. And that's what one must do, but it's important. There must be no membership, because the minute there's a membership, then someone farms another person and they control the people to make money. No membership. Anyone can come. Anyone can speak, and there's no costs, and it's for free. And it's important to maybe hold this at a university, which is a neutral area. But I don't know. We've had the Farmers Lab in many other places. But this is the thing. And then the Farmers Lab is also connected to bigger. There's the Technology Forum, the Business Forum, and then we have a Stakeholders Forum, where the stakeholders from high up in the state business, where we prepare them to gain entry into the Farmers Lab. And one must do this, and you must be open to change and experiment. But this is, I believe, the way to go, is to create a regular event. We are every month, 10 times a year, we have the event. Farmers know, and businesses know, they can come and they can get their stuff realized. And the bad businesses don't come, and the good ones come. So we have ethical butchers who only sell ethical meat. We have ethical feed suppliers, etc., etc. So I would say that's the way to go.
Thank you very much, Naude. It's a lot of information to think, and I believe that in Ukraine we are moving the same way, because now we are connecting the initiative which is called Green School. It's a kind of different business initiative, permaculture community, then Global Eco Village Network, worldwide opportunities on organic farms. Basically, to make productive and to find the way how to connect all this network, we definitely will use some of your advices. So thank you very much for this wonderful start of our conference. And we will additionally translate your lecture on Saturday in Ukrainian. And so more people will get a clue and hopefully have some questions, which could they contact you somewhere on Facebook or by mail?
Yeah, the best is to contact me on the email, because I'm on the email all the time. And you are very, very welcome. And if you guys want to come to the Soweto eating, I can help. I'll make a plan. You know, please, you are welcome.
Thank you very much, Naude. So I wish good luck to you, and I hope that we will continue some collaboration or information exchange. Thank you very much.
Yes, thank you. I look forward to that. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Goodbye.
Bye-bye.